For a long time, there was not much recognition that our coastal wetlands for us, like here in New England, our salt marsh environments, were doing such an incredible job of storing carbon. And so for a long time, that service, that benefit, was under-recognized by many people. But over the last several years, we've been part of the story in terms of helping to facilitate and work with a team that's doing research on that concept and actually trying to build out what are the potential avenues to apply our knowledge about blue carbon in different ways.
So blue carbon is really just the term that we use to talk about the carbon that's stored in coastal and marine ecosystems, including salt marshes, mangroves, and seagrass systems. These are very productive plants. They grow fairly fast, and so they're capturing carbon at a rate that's quicker than a lot of our terrestrial forest systems. And we know that our terrestrial systems, our tropical and temperate forests, have gained a lot of ground and recognition for their climate mitigation services. We want to see our coastal wetlands valued similarly.
So what we're talking about is using wetlands, tidal wetlands, salt marshes, mangroves, and seagrasses in carbon markets.
So the carbon market, I would kind of divide into a regulated market and a voluntary carbon market. So a regulated carbon market is just how it sounds. It's regulated by some government or entity. Now, on the other side of that is the voluntary carbon market, and as the name suggests, it's voluntary. So this is companies, governments, individuals who want to lower their carbon footprint, and they purchase carbon offsets on the carbon market.
When we started the Bringing Wetlands to Market project, we knew that we had to look at the whole carbon and greenhouse gas system comprehensively. As we began to investigate the coastal wetlands, the salt marshes seem to be the most important piece because they do store a large amount of carbon at a rapid rate. And so that was a pretty substantial focus of Bringing Wetlands to Market One, was to get good quality quantification of greenhouse gases in coastal ecosystems.
The science is so important to have. I mean, when we're talking about conservation and all the benefits of natural habitat, it can be very hard to monetize those benefits. And here we have a benefit of carbon capture and storage that we have put a price on, that we can monetize. And so here's this brand new opportunity to then bring these habitats into the market system, put that dollar value on that people will then pay for. And that science gives us the numbers. It helps us quantify that benefit. It's so critical.
Then you're actually using that carbon market to help with conservation and restoration. But you're never restoring a place for just the blue carbon benefits.
You're also getting that improved water quality. You're getting that shoreline protection from storms and flooding.
So they have economic importance in terms of sustaining fisheries populations.
The recreational benefit is also pretty huge. So when you go down all those different things, from both recreation to resilience to climate change mitigation to water filtration, it's a huge list of very important benefits these wetlands provide.
This is science that's impactful, that has immediate impact on this really large, seemingly unassailable problem of climate change.
We're working with partners in the Herring River area, one of the largest potential wetland restoration projects. And what has happened now is they've integrated this idea of the blue carbon benefit that this restoration project could deliver as part of their story. It's now a part of the conversation where it wasn't before.
So our hope is that once the Herring River project gets fully funded for the restoration, that we can also develop it as a carbon offset project. We have companies and organizations contacting us and wanting to buy blue carbon credits, which is really wonderful, very encouraging that, you know, they see that as a great way that they can have a part to play in climate mitigation.
So the message of hope is just to understand that these natural places are working for us. If we can work for them in terms of helping them stay resilient, restore them, conserve them where we can, protect them as much as we can, and know that just by doing that step, we're helping to be solutions oriented, and keeping that at the forefront of our mind as we do our work, I think does bring hope.